I want you to open your Bibles with me to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15 and verse 11, he said, "A certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, 'Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me.' And he divided unto them his living. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husks that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, 'How many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father and will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants.' And he arose and came to his father, and when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and in thy sight, and am no more worthy to be called thy son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Bring forth the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand, shoes on his feet, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' And they began to be merry. Now his elder son was in the field, and as he came, he heard music and dancing. And he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said unto him, 'Thy brother is come, and thy father hath killed the fatted calf, because he hath received him safe and sound.' And he was angry and would not go in. Therefore came his father out and entreated him. And he answering said to his father, 'Lo, these many years do I serve thee, neither transgressed I at any time thy commandment. And yet thou never gavest me a kid that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this thy son was come, which hath devoured thy living with harlots, thou hast killed for him the fatted calf.' And he said unto him, 'Son, thou art ever with me, and all that I have is thine. It was meet that we should make merry and be glad, for this thy brother was dead and is alive again, and was lost and is found.'" The top of the page in my Bible says the prodigal son. I like to refer to this as the love of the father. I believe the emphasis should be on the love of the father. Jesus is giving this illustration to speak of our father, our heavenly father. The love of our heavenly father. This is a picture of our father. This is a picture of me. This is a picture of you. This is a picture of any and all who have and would go astray. And the response to repentance, the response to humility. I like the phraseology, when he came to himself. It's good when someone comes to himself. And this is the response of the father. It's not always the response of people, but it is always the response of the Father. I want to call to your attention a scripture in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 7. Ask, and it shall be given you. Seek, and ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened unto you. The Greek, and some translations, the Amplified Bible and other translations would give more insight into the actual Greek. It's ask and keep asking. But that would not go along with other scripture where Jesus said they think they'll be heard for their much speaking. So it's not repetitive, some monotonous, repetitive chant of a prayer, but it's ask and keep standing. Ask and keep believing. Ask and stay with it the way a farmer would the ground where he sowed some seed and he doesn't have a harvest yet, but he keeps working with it, tending to it, weeding it, watering it, fertilizing it, tending to it because it's good ground, it's good seed, and he's going to stay with it. Keep the pest out. So that's what that means. Ask and stand your ground. Seek and stand your ground. Knock and stand your ground. So it's stay with it. For everyone, verse 8, Matthew 7, verse 8, for everyone. Now, does that say everyone except me? Does it say that? Everyone except me? Does it say that? Everyone except me. Don't turn to your neighbor and say, now that's everyone except you. The devil might say that. Now that's everyone except you. You don't qualify. Don't you know what you've done? Don't you remember what you did? You don't qualify. I tell you, that prodigal son didn't think he qualified. His attitude was, I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy. Make me a hireling. Make me a servant. I'm not even worthy to be a son. And the devil would say to you, you're not worthy. Look at what you've done. But this is Jesus talking now. This is the Father talking now. In fact, he talked more about the Father than anyone before him. He came talking about God as Father. In the Lord's Prayer, he said, our Father. He came talking about God, referring to him as Father. He's the Father of spirits. He's my Father. Everyone that asketh receiveth, he that seeketh findeth, that is, stay with it. He that, to him that knocketh, it shall be open, that is, stay with it. One thing that I say often, and I'm going to keep saying it, is stay with it. Don't quit. Don't give up. Stay with it. Why? God is faithful. I know there's opposition. I know there's challenges. I know there are tests and trials. I know sometimes it looks like it's not working. Stay with it. Why? God is faithful. Jesus said it before I said it. He's saying it here. Stay with it. Everyone that stays with it receives. And then he goes on to explain why. What man is there of you whom if his son ask bread, will he give him a stone? I'm hungry. I'd like some bread to eat. Well, here's a plate full of rocks. No, we don't do that. In fact, you chuckled because we don't do that. Anyone eat rocks this morning for breakfast? So he's asking the question, and if your child asks for a fish, instead of a fish, do you put a snake on the plate? Well, if you, being natural, the word evil there means natural. If you, being natural, know how to give good gifts to your children, and good parents. Now, not all parents today are good parents, but good parents want good for their children. I mean, I speak to parents that say, I want better for my children than I ever had. They want their children to have a better education than they had. They want their children to have a better vocation and a better career and a better income than they ever had. I mean, good parents. Some parents are jealous and competitive even with their own children. But good parents want good for their children. And so Jesus is saying, find the best of the lot among you. But still, in the eyes of God, you don't compare with God and the love of our Heavenly Father. You want to give good to your children. And you're just natural in the natural world. In the he said evil in the King James Version. It says evil. He's talking about you're just natural. They talk about the love of the mother. There's no greater love than the love of the mother. The love of the mother compared to God's love is really a selfish love. But the love of our Heavenly Father is no greater love. And he says, you're natural and you want to give good to your children. You don't tell your little baby, now the burner's hot, honey, let me show you. And take that baby's hand and put it on the stove. And the baby jerks it away and cries. And you go, see, you learned something, didn't you? You learn that's hot. But in church, we've been taught that's how God is. God will put that on you to teach you. That's what we've been taught in church. God did that to you to teach you. Well, we don't do our children that way. Let me teach you that fire's hot. Here, give me your hand. And push that hand into the fire. And they jerk it away and cry and bawl and squall. You see, you learned something, didn't you? You learned that's hot. I'm so glad you learned that important lesson, and they go away scarred. And Jesus is saying, you're good. You give good things to your children. And just, he used the word evil in the King James Version. He means you're natural, and you know how to give good gifts to your children. How much more? I have that underlined. I don't know when I did, many years ago. Not just a little more, not just some more. But much more, way beyond what you could ever do for your children. God wants to do much more for you. Well, we're going to make the baby sick so they can learn something. Well, God put this sickness to teach me something. It's amazing. Even the people that believe that God, it's the will of God that I be sick, so I'd bear admirably underneath it. And they go to the doctor to try to get out of the will of God. I believe it's the will of God, then I'm sick. Then why are you trying so hard to get out of the will of God? Well, God put this on me. Well, we ought to pray for a double portion. Make them double sick. Just give them double symptoms. Well, do you do your children that way? What good parent makes their child have cancer, makes their child have tuberculosis, makes their child have a... bronchitis, makes the child have asthma. I put that asthma on him so he would learn something. What good parent does that? Well, how much more will your Heavenly Father give good things to them that ask him? He still wants you to ask. He wants you to ask. He wants you to ask. But he's a good father. And Jesus didn't say God. He's referring to the Father and children, and he's comparing the Heavenly Father to the natural Father. Well, how many of you, when your child, now this story is also in Luke chapter 11. In Luke 11, he mentions the egg and the scorpion. Here, it's the bread and the stone. It's the fish and the serpent. In Luke 11, he says, your child asks for an egg, but you give him a scorpion. Your child asks for bread, you give him a stone. Your child asks for fish, you give him a serpent. Do you do that? Well, your Heavenly Father doesn't do that for you. When you ask him, well, he knows what I need. He knows best. Well, I know that some people ask out of, James said, you ask and receive not because you asked to amiss to consume it upon your own lust. But when you find it in the Word of God, then you can ask for it. And your Heavenly Father wants you to have it. I believe God takes pleasure in the prosperity of his servants, just like the Bible says. And if not, if his servants, how much more his children? I believe he wants us to be in health. I wish above all things that you prosper and be in health. Isn't that what 3 John says? Even as your souls prosper. I wish above all things. Is that what he said in 3 John verse 2? 3 John verse 2, I wish above all things that you prosper and be in sickness. Health. Health. It's God's will that we prosper. It's God's will that we be in health. And good parents, I speak to parents. They want good for their children. I want my children to have better than I ever had. Well, your heavenly Father wants you to have everything Jesus came to have for you. I'm an heir of God, a joint heir with Jesus Christ. Whatever Jesus came to have, he came for me to have in him. I'm an heir of God, a joint heir with Jesus Christ. And he's my Father, I'm his child, and he wants to do much more, not just a little more, not just some more, but much more. He doesn't want to do just some more, just a little more. He wants to do much more, not just a little more, not just some more, but much more. You think on that, it'll just give you a shouting time on the inside. He doesn't want to just do a little more than I want to do. You know, even if he wanted to do the same as I want to do for my children, that's good. I want good for my children. My heavenly Father wants good for me. But he doesn't want to do just a little more. He doesn't want to do just some more. He wants to do much more than you could ever want for your children or any parent could ever want for their child. You find the best of the lot. Find the best parent that there is on this earth. God wants much more. Your heavenly Father wants much more. People say, I would bear that if I could. They see their children suffering, and the parents would say, I would suffer if I could. I've heard people even pray, Lord, put that on me. Well, he's never going to do that. He put it on Jesus. I've even heard people say this, I'm suffering so somebody will see my life and turn to God. If I have to suffer, I heard about a woman who said, I'm suffering under this so my husband will turn to God. Most of the time, it makes them bitter toward God. If you tell them God did it. But she was suffering. If I have to suffer like this, and this is what it takes so my husband will be saved. That's what she said. Well, that's why God put it on Jesus. He's not putting it on you. He put it on Jesus. Jesus came and suffered. He came, and by whose stripes I was healed. He came and bore the curse. He became the curse. He came and he became sin, who knew no sin. For us, why? So we could be made the righteousness of God in him. And by whose stripes I was healed. I don't need to be sick when he himself took my infirmities and bore my sicknesses. I don't need to take it when he took it. I don't need to bear it when he bore it. He, God the Father, put it on Jesus so I wouldn't have it anymore. Hallelujah. And there's parents today that would say, I would bear that if I could. They see their suffering children. They say, I would, if I only could, I would take that so they could be well. And God did that for you. He put it on Jesus so you could be well. Hallelujah. I wish above all things that you what? Go through some struggles. I wish above all things that you what? Prosper and be in health, even as your souls prosper. How much more? Say that out loud, those three words. Close your eyes and let it resonate on your spirit and say those words. Lift your hand and close your eyes and let it resonate on your spirit. Say those three words. What's he talking about? Giving good things to his children. Giving good things to his children. Our heavenly Father gives good things to his children. In Luke chapter 15, this is a picture of the Father. And it says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself. When I see Jesus on the cross, I see God. God was in Christ, reconciling the world. Who is on the cross? That's Jesus on the cross. 2 Corinthians 5 says God was in Christ. That's God. That's the will of God. That's why Jesus prayed, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. That's the will of the Father to put on the Lord Jesus Christ, the suffering of sighing, crying, dying humanity. So we could be free in him. He's redeeming the world and all who would come As many as called upon the name of the Lord are saved. As many as come to him are redeemed and saved. Hallelujah. He gives the power or the authority, the right, the ability to become children of God. As many as come to him and call upon the name of the Lord. He gives us the authority, the right, the ability to be born again, to come from darkness to light, to be born again, to be children of God, where we can cry, Abba, Father. Abba, Father. God was in Christ, reconciling the world. The prodigal son had it good, but he said, let me have my inheritance. And he took it and he spent it. And then he's in famine. He's hungry. He's destitute. And he says, I know what I'm going to do. The Bible says in Luke 15, he came to himself. My father has hirelings, servants that are doing better than this. If I was just back at father's house as a servant, I'd be doing better than this. I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to repent and go home. I'm going to repent and go home. Now, in that day, and the son knew it, there's a word that is used. It's K-E-Z-A-Z-A-H. K-E-Z-A-Z-A-H. Kezazah. Some may pronounce it Kezazah. 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 It's a ceremony that was common in that day, that when you've taken the inheritance, you've left the family and you've squandered, you've taken company and fellowship with the Gentiles and you've spent all of the money. The picture of the prodigal son fit this, that you can't come back. And when you come to the village, you would stop at the gate and the elders of the tribe, the elders of the community would greet you at the gate and they would have a ceremony that they called Kezazah. They would take a clay pot and they would break it to symbolize the broken fellowship. And I also read somewhere that it was a clay pot filled with burnt beans. And they would take this clay pot and they would say, Kezazah. And they would break this clay pot to spill out the burnt beans. And it would be a symbol of the broken relationship, the broken fellowship. There is no restitution for you. You are not welcome here. You cannot come back into the village. You cannot come back into the family. You cannot come back into the fellowship. You are banished. Well, the son knew that. Well, I won't come back to the family, but I'll come to be a servant. Well, the father saw him a great way off. And in that day, the father, when the ceremony occurred, the father couldn't even come because of the shame. The mother could come, the family could come to view the ceremony, but the father couldn't even come. But the father knows that this is going to happen to his son. When his son comes home, the elders of the tribe are going to prevent his restoration. But if I get there first. So he saw him a great way off and ran. And in that day, it would be against all dignity for an elder. An adult male did not run. He would send his servants to run. But an adult male did not run. It was undignified. In order to do so, he would have to tuck up the robe or he would trip. And to do so, he would bare his legs and he would lose all dignity. You did not do that. It would be a shame. You would be undignified. It would be a reproach to the family for the adult male to bare his legs and to run. But the father did. Jesus knows the custom. He's given the illustration. The Heavenly Father will break custom for restoration. there's nothing more important than the restoration. I'm going to prevent the banishment. There will be no Kezazah today. The devil says, you're not worthy. Don't you remember what you did? You're not deserving. Don't you know what you've done? But the Heavenly Father says there will be no Kezazah today. What are we going to do instead? We're going to find the best robe. Not just any robe, but the best one. That's what you're going to put on. What are we going to do? We're going to kill the fatted calf, not the skinny one. What are we going to do? We're going to put shoes on his feet. The ring is the signet ring that signifies you're in the family. You're in the family. You have the family name. Whatever this family signifies, you signify. You have the family name. I tell you, I can face opposition and I can say to the devil, I have the family name. Whatever I ask in the name of Jesus. Jesus said in John 16, whatever you ask the Father in my name. Why? With my ring on your finger. You're in the family. Whatever the family has, you have. There will be no Kezazah today. It's not based on what he's done. It's not based on where he's been. It's not based on how long he's been gone. When I see him, I'm going to run to him and fall on his neck and kiss him. He fell on his neck and kissed him. I know I want to kiss my Lord Jesus Christ. But regardless of how my mind might struggle, the Word of God teaches me he falls on my neck and kisses me. There will be no Kezazah today. We're going to make merry. The older brother didn't even come in. And then the father went out and entreated him. Come on in. He wouldn't even call him brother. He said, this your son. Now the father called him brother. Your brother is home. Your brother is home. He wouldn't call him brother. He said, your son. And he talked the same talk the accuser of the brethren talks. Look at what he has done. I never did any of that. You never did any of this for me. And the father said, all I have is yours. You could have had a party anytime you wanted to. Everything I have is yours. Everything I have is his. Everything I have is yours. The Father loves his sons, his children. Everything he has is yours. And even when the brother had a bad attitude, the father is reaching out to him. He's interested in restoration. He entreated him. He went out to tell the brother, there will be no Kezazah today. Your brother is home. Can you say amen? That's a picture of my Heavenly Father. That's a picture of my Heavenly Father and his eyes upon me. There will be no
Kezazah today.